Good afternoon. Our program today comes from the Dorchester Hotel in London. My guest was born 56 years ago this month and lived just about 7 miles away up the road from here. And since then has become the most famous film star in the world, Elizabeth Taylor. Correct. It is about that, isn't it? The most famous film star in the world.
I don't know. I haven't really worked very much in films for the last 7 or 8 years. But I guess I'm famous for something.
When I read, you know, some books about you, one of your early ones, in fact, about yourself, I was suddenly very surprised because I'd completely forgotten you'd been born in England. I mean, you've lived so long away. And I suddenly thought, since you've been having to reassess yourself quite a lot lately, you must have gone back to that beginning, those first 7 years in London, in Hampstead Heath.
Yes, and in Kent, where we had a country house. They were very, very happy years.
I mean, do they remain intact as very happy?
Yes.
I mean, the happiest, would you say, or couldn't you say
no,
that?
No, because I was a child, and life consisted of my family, going to school, dancing, which I loved, ballet dancing, and riding my horse. That was my passion in life. It was a small, exclusive, happy dream world.
And then wham, you went into another big dream world, which was in films. I mean, Fantasyland itself.
Fantasyland, where I had to learn to differentiate between fantasy and fact, so as not to get lost in the mix-up. I had to learn who I was and who Elizabeth Taylor inside was and what Elizabeth Taylor on the outside was, and that they were two different entities.
But then you've just written this book, and it really is a description of somehow having lost yourself. I mean, you use a phrase in it which I thought was very powerful. You said that you zeroed into self-destruction.
I did, and I very well almost succeeded.
You know that in the book you actually point out the fact that when you became Mrs. John
Warner.
Yeah, the senator, that is where you began to see yourself going into some decline, didn't you? I mean, you didn't blame him, but you blamed
not at all.
What was happening to you.
I allowed it to happen to myself. I became completely inactive. I would do as many things as they would allow me to do, or as I found possible. I would visit mentally retarded children and senior citizens, but I couldn't do that every day. There was really nothing for me as a senator's wife to do in Washington. We met once a month and would go for a briefing at the White House, which was really a sort of silly formality, and I felt totally redundant, really, I guess, for the first time in my life. I had no purpose, I had nothing to do, I really had no meaning.
But when, you know, there was a part in the book where just when you were going to go out on the road with him, canvassing, right, campaigning, you said that people said to you, you'll never make it, you know, you'll never do it, you know, you won't be able to manage on your own, you won't be able to manage without people doing your hair, dressing you, etc., right? And you thought you would manage that, and you did manage that, didn't you? That wasn't the part. Exactly.
But and yet, I enjoyed the campaigning. It was a challenge, and it was bloody difficult. Sometimes up at 4:30 in the morning, flying around Virginia in one-engine planes and landing in meadows and knocking on front doors, asking if you could borrow their loo.
and a broken bone in your hand from having shaken so many hands.
Sometimes in a day, 5,000 hands.
So at that point, you see, it occurred to me when I read that about you, that I thought, well, perhaps all your life, you've always had people dressing you and doing your hair and making you up. And in a way, that keeps you out of contact with yourself, I'd have thought, in some odd way.
Well, I've always done my own makeup.
Yeah.
And I do know how to do my own hair. Mm. So I've managed to keep in touch with reality. Mm. And actually, my family helped me do that when I was very young. Mm. And most of my friends, if I had very few, were really, except for Roddy McDowell, outside show business. Mm. And still, my favorite thing was riding my horse. Mm.
So what do you think happened that you went on such a binge of eating and such a decline?
I think perhaps, in a way, in my subconscious, I was really seeking obscurity. I wanted to retire. The media didn't allow me to. I wanted to be Mrs. Senator. I didn't think it was anybody's damn business whether I was fat, thin. It was my concern, my husband's. He liked me that way. And I rather resented that, I think. Anyway, I became recalcitrant, dug my heels in, and just ate more. Because I thought, it's my body, my life. If I want to be fat, why should it bother anybody out there?
But it happened to you at the time when it happens to a lot of women. Your children have left home. You're suddenly with a husband who was very important in his own right, and his job was very important, and you thought that was right. Like you always said that you give 100% of yourself to the man you love, right? Mm. But then suddenly you were left absolutely in limbo. That's what it struck me as. Am I wrong?
No, you're quite right. And I think that's when I began to flounder. Mm. And we never really could plan anything. Like a married couple, newly married, to have people over for dinner, or just have a quiet dinner, just the two of us at home, or go out for a quiet dinner. Mm. He never knew what time he would be home. The Senate could sit in session until 11 or 12. Sometimes he'd come home at 9 with papers stacked this high. I never knew what time to tell the cook to have dinner ready. So we'd always have to kind of eat on the run. Sometimes he'd eat in the den, and I'd eat upstairs so as not to bother him. And you couldn't plan an existence. You couldn't plan anything for weekends. You couldn't count on 2 hours ahead.
But then when you became sort of, as you said, excessively fat, and you sort of felt as you had no self...
Obese is what I
obese.
Said.
Obese. I didn't like to say that word. It does sound worse. But, I mean, you sort of seemed to not be able to come to grips with who you were at all. Now, that couldn't have just been that part of your life. That must have been an accumulation of a lot of something else.
Of course, it had to do with alcoholism and my pill addiction. They were all cross-addicted. I don't get into that so much in the book because it's too important to just include. This book is about diet and weight gain and weight control. The other is a very serious topic, and maybe one day I'll write about that. It's too serious to slough over, and I'm not trying to in this book. I don't dwell on it or go into it in detail because it's just too important. But of course that was part of it.
But, you know, just if you diet, right? I mean, just give me hope because I don't want to diet. But if you diet and you get thinner, does that restore your self-esteem? Can it, do you think?
I don't think that in itself.
No.
But the very fact that you want to go on a diet, that you get the desire, that you get the click to do something about the way you look, means that you already have something inside that has changed in your self-esteem. Mm. In order to go on a diet, it's already there. Mm. If you're not happy with the way you look and you want to improve the way you look and do something about it, because it takes your decision, it's your desire, otherwise it can't be accomplished. You can go on fad diets, you can go to fat farms, and it will only be a temporary thing. Mm. In order to make it last, in order to maintain it, you have to have the desire. You're the only one that can make it stick. You're the only one that can make it work. And that already begins here and here. It's the click. Mm.